Hey everyone, Dr.Mungli here. So in this video, I will be explaining you the metabolic changes that are going on in our body during fasting condition and starvation. Now during fasting conditions, when we are going to say a person is in fasting condition, strictly speaking, fasting condition, it begins 10 hours after the meals. That's the strictly speaking. Otherwise, loosely speaking, so we just say 2 to 3 hours after meals, we just say person is in fasting condition. Actually, that is post-absorptive condition. Anyway, for our purpose here, so in this video, I will be considering 2 to 3 hours after your last meal as a fasting condition. That's what I have written here. So 2 hours after meals, and then 12 hours after meals, and up to 24 hours after meals, that I have just written it as a fasting condition here. And then after that, it is in days, and then in weeks. Now, anyone who is not taking food more than 24 hours, they just get into starvation. That is what is referred as starvation. Fasting is within 24 hours. We're not taking anything for 24 hours. That is in fact, that is basically fasting. And if you don't take anything more than 24 hours, that is basically referred as starvation. Okay. Now what happens during fasting condition are 2 to 3 hours after meals. So 2 to 3 hours after meals, our blood glucose level falls down. So I'm going to write down the blood glucose concentration. So blood glucose, it continuously falling down, and then it will just maintain a constant phase. Okay, so this is what happens under fasting conditions. And the blood glucose, this line is indicative of blood glucose. All the things that I'm writing here is in the blood, so I'll just write it as glucose here. So glucose levels falls. So as you can see, continuous fall in the glucose level, and then it just maintains a constant phase there. Now, as the blood glucose level falls, your insulin levels will also fall down. As the insulin level falls, so as you all know, glucagon levels will rise. So I'm going to write a glucagon level. So insulin is coming from beta cells of pancreas and glucagon is coming from alpha cells of pancreas. Generally, insulin has got a negative effect or inhibitory effect on alpha cells of pancreas. So as the insulin level falls, so the glucagon level will rise. So there will be rise in the glucagon level as the insulin level is falling down. So it will be like this. So we have glucagon here. So now, what is the metabolic effect of glucagon on our body? So, you know, glucagon is a catabolic hormone as opposed to insulin. Insulin is an anabolic hormone. Now, a person is in fasting conditions, say 2 to 3 hours after meals. So, slowly insulin is dropping down and glucagon is rising. So, this glucagon is going to break down our energy sources. What are the energy sources that we have? So we have glycogen in the liver, we have glycogen in the skeletal muscle and other tissues. So glucagon, it is going to go and bind to glucagon receptors in the hepatocyte, and it's going to break down glycogen by stimulating an enzyme called glycogen phosphorylase enzyme. Now this glycogen degradation is going on in the liver. So I'm going to write the glycogen degradation now. So it starts 2 to 3 hours after meals, and it peaks by 12 hours, and it reaches to, basically it is depleted by 24 hours of fasting. So glycogen degradation, this is the glycogen degradation here, mediated by glycogen phosphorylase, and that is stimulated by glucagon hormone. So glycogen degradation starts 2 to 3 hours after meals, peaks by 12 hours and depletes completely by 24 hours. It can vary from person to person depending on their previous carbohydrate intake. Some people's their glycogen can last only for 12 hours. In some other, it can last for 24 hours. In a person who is taking well-balanced diet, who is 70 kg, in those people, so glycogen can last for 24 hours. So this glycogen, which is breaking down into glucose, 1-phosphate, further it is converted into glucose, and that will maintain the blood glucose level under fasting condition. So basically, person will have a fasting blood glucose level. So now what else is going on here? So as the glucagon is increased here, so glucagon not only it breaks glycogen stores, it is also going to break a lipid store present in our body. Where do you have a lipid store? Where is the lipid stored in our body? It is stored beneath our skin, that is the adipose tissue. Adipose tissue has got, white adipose tissue has got triacyl glycerol, and this triacyl glycerol can be broken down to give energy for our cells. So, glucagon, it is going to go and activate hormone sensitive lipase. Glucagon is binding to glucagon receptors on the adipose tissue, and it's going to activate hormone sensitive lipase, and that hormone sensitive lipase, it is going to release free fatty acids and glycerol into the blood, and free fatty acids will be taken up by peripheral tissues. Almost all tissues in our body except red blood cells and the brain, so they can use free fatty acids for their energy. So they will conduct beta oxidation process. Skeletal muscle, cardiocytes, all the other tissues including the liver, it's going to conduct beta oxidation, break down fatty acids and release acetyl-CoA, and acetyl-CoA will get into TCA cycle to give energy. Okay, so in the influence of glucagon, so your free fatty acids floods into the blood. So I'm going to write that now. So 2 to 3 hours after meals, so free fatty acid continuously, they are going to rise as the fasting goes on, and as the person gets into starvation, free fatty acid rises. So these free fatty acids will be used by almost all tissues in our body except red blood cells and the brain. So there will be gradual, that means there will be continuous rise in the free fatty acids in our body. Okay, so now the glycerol that is coming from triacyl glycerol, as the adipose tissue is broken down into free fatty acid and the glycerol. So glycerol is taken up by the liver. Free fatty acids predominantly taken up by the liver and the other tissues. Glycerol mainly it will be taken up by the liver. So what liver does with the glycerol? Glycerol it will be converted into glucose in the liver. Liver has glycerol kinase enzyme, glycerol 3-phosphate dehydrogenase enzyme, and ultimately glycerol is going into glucose formation by a process called as gluconeogenesis. So not only glycerol coming from triacyl glycerol gets into gluconeogenesis, gluconeogenesis can also be done with the using lactate. Lactate is coming from red blood cells because red blood cells, they conduct anaerobic glycolysis. So in anaerobic glycolysis, you get lactate. Lactate gets into the blood. It will be taken up by the liver and heart. So in the liver, what happens? Lactate is converted back into glucose by gluconeogenesis. Now, some of the amino acids can also be converted into glucose. Like out of 20 amino acids, 18 of them can be converted to glucose. So let's see how what is the timeline for gluconeogenesis. Gluconeogenesis, it starts 2 to 3 hours after meals. 2 to 3 hours after meals, gluconeogenesis starts, but it will be there at a basal level. So this is the gluconeogenesis line here. It will be there at a basal level because your still glycogen degradation is going on. So at 12 hours, your glycogen degradation is at peak and it is depleted by 24 hours. As the glycogen degradation is depleted, see the gluconeogenesis that is going on at a very basal level here, it will start to rise at 12 hours. By 12 hours, it is steaming up, and by 24 hours it is at peak. Your gluconeogenesis is at peak by 24 hours. By that time your glycogen degradation is already down, it is totally depleted. So now the glucose maintenance, this is the glucose here, so the maintenance of blood glucose level, it will be done by gluconeogenesis process. Now as the gluconeogenesis process reaches peak here, by 24 hours your gluconeogenesis is at peak. By that time you know that the glycogen degradation is already down here, totally depleted. Now this gluconeogenesis further, it is going to continue for at the peak level for another 1 week. Basically for 1 week it will be at peak. As you can see, this is 1 week period here, so your gluconeogenesis is at peak. And after that it is going to fall down. Gluconeogenesis is going to drop by second week, and then it just maintains at a constant level. Okay, so now what are the sources? As you can see, as the gluconeogenesis is falling down, even the blood glucose levels also falls down and just maintained in a constant phase. Now what are the sources for what are the precursors for gluconeogenesis under this condition? So initially from 2 to 3 hours and then 12 hours up to 24 hours in this particular period, so how the glucose is made. It is made from by you convert glycerol into glucose. Glycerol, you know, it is coming from triacylglycerol. It is made from converting lactate into glucose in the liver, and also some of the amino acids present in the hepatocytes. And also amino acids coming from the muscle, not really because of breakdown of skeletal muscle. So breakdown of skeletal muscle doesn't go on until more than 24 hours to 48 hours. It takes 24 hours to 48 hours for our skeletal muscle proteins to undergo proteolysis. So the amino acids that are coming from skeletal muscle, actually they are all coming from the transamination process. What happens during transamination? Let me explain the transamination. So, whenever person is in fasting condition, see there is a glucagon is elevated, releasing free fatty acids. Free fatty acids gets into the skeletal muscles, skeletal muscle conduct beta oxidation process, and they will get acetyl-CoA from beta oxidation. Acetyl-CoA levels rises. As the acetyl-CoA level rises, acetyl-CoA will have a negative effect on pyruvate dehydrogenase complex. So, that means glucose which is converted to pyruvate, which is further is not converted to acetyl-CoA, because excess acetyl-CoA from beta oxidation of fatty acids in skeletal muscle will have a negative effect on pyruvate dehydrogenase complex. Thereby pyruvate accumulates, and this accumulated pyruvate, it will undergo transamination reaction. So with the glutamate, amino acid glutamate, so with this transamination what happens, pyruvate is converted to alanine, glutamate is converted to alpha-ketoglutarate. You can watch my video on transamination. Link for that is appearing right now on the right upper corner. Now, with pyruvate undergoing transamination, it is converted to alanine, and alanine is coming into the blood, and that will be taken up by the liver, and that will participate in gluconeogenesis process. That is what happens within 24 hours of this gluconeogenesis period. So the major sources or the precursors for gluconeogenesis within that 24 hours, I would say it is glycerol, lactate, and the amino acid coming from the muscle, especially from transamination reaction, which is coming from pyruvate. Okay, after 24 hours, what happens? So after 24 hours, 24 to 48 hours period, so it is the proteolysis that can go on in the skeletal muscle, especially because by that time even the cortisol will be elevated, because the person is in starvation, it's a stressful situation. So the cortisol level build up in the blood. So that cortisol can lead to proteolysis in the skeletal muscle, and the skeletal muscle proteins will be broken down to release amino acids. So that amino acids will go to the liver, and in the liver some of these amino acids will go into gluconeogenesis process to maintain blood glucose level, and also some amino acids in the liver can be going into protein synthesis to make essential proteins that are needed for metabolic processes in the liver. That is why the skeletal muscle protein acts as a source for amino acids in the liver. But so for that to happen, the starvation has to be 24 to 48 hours, and then it continues there until like 7 days. After that, you see there is a drop in these gluconeogenesis, because by that time 50 to 60% of the skeletal muscle is already proteolyzed. So growth hormone comes in and it will decrease the proteolysis, and thereby gluconeogenesis just drops and continues in a constant phase. And in this phase, gluconeogenic precursors are glycerol and lactate again, because glycerol is coming from continuous degradation of triacylglycerol into free fatty acids and glycerol, and the lactate is coming from anaerobic glycolysis. So this is what happens in relation to gluconeogenesis process. Now see, as the free fatty acids are coming into the liver, so liver is conducting beta oxidation. Beta oxidation will give you acetyl-CoA, and acetyl-CoA will saturate TCA cycle. Once TCA cycle is saturated, so the excess acetyl-CoA, they will be diverted into ketone body formation. Ketone bodies for formation start like 12 hours after fasting. They are basically at the baseline. You don't really see them much in the blood. But after 24 hours, so they start to appear in the blood. So by the 3 days, as you can see, there is a significant appearance of ketone bodies there. And they are going to rise as the starvation, like fasting and going to starvation, as the starvation occurs, so ketone body rises. So this is the ketones here. So ketones will rise, will appear significantly 24 hours after starvation, and they'll continuously rise as long as free fatty acids are available there. Okay. Now, most of our cells, when a person is in fasting condition, they are all adapted, they are using free fatty acids. As the ketone bodies are appearing in the blood, so our cells will adapt themselves to use ketone bodies also, especially the brain. Brain takes 2 to 3 days to adapt for ketone bodies. It will start using ketone bodies. As the brain start using ketone bodies, by third day, around 30% of the energy needs of brain will come from ketone bodies. That means it is going to save this glucose for red blood cells. So because it knows as the days goes, your gluconeogenesis is going to fall down, blood glucose level goes to go down. So that means by that time your brain is already adapting itself to use ketone body. By 1 week, your brain is almost using ketone bodies as its energy source. It is sparing glucose for red blood cell. In the same way, even the skeletal muscle and other tissues like heart, they all will use ketone bodies. Eventually, they will revert back to use of fatty acids, because ketone bodies will be predominantly used by the brain after 1 to 2 weeks of starvation. Okay, so this is how the metabolic adaptations will go on in our body. So for that, there will be a lot of hormonal changes going on. So insulin dropping, glucagon increasing, and later on cortisol coming in, and then growth hormone coming in. So all these hormones, they will alter the metabolic pathways and make sure that our cells will get all the energy that they need. So in one or the other form, initially it will be coming from a glycogen giving glucose, after that gluconeogenesis giving glucose, and then the free fatty acids giving energy, and later body getting into keto adaptation process. So this is all about metabolic changes that are going on during fasting condition and starvation. I hope this video has helped you in understanding this concept. If you have any question, so kindly let me know about that in the comment section below. So I will answer to them as soon as possible. So thanks for watching, and for regular updates, you can consider subscribing to this channel, and also click on the bell button there so that you get the notification as and when I upload the video. Thanks again, and have a good day.